better. Glad you're here. This is a very special occasion, and it's wonderful that God still calls people into the ministry. But what is more wonderful is when those that are called answer.
Amen.
And the answer is yes. And I'm going to tell Steve like Jimmy Lee Chronister told me. This is, being a minister, is one of the most rewarding, heart-wrenching, heartbreaking thing you will ever do in your life. You get rewards, and then the old devil tries to throw things in your face, and all of us ministers that are here can attest to the fact that when things seem to be going good, Brother Freddie, it's not long till something pops up that he tries to bring us down. But it is great to be here. We hope that we come not just as friends and family to honor Steve. And not just Steve. We've got to remember that Vicki will be a big part of his ministry. She will be either a help or a hindrance. And I'll let y'all decide which one. But a wife to a minister means a great deal. The minister kind of uses them as a soundboard, a shoulder to cry on when things are not seems to be as what they should be. And we're just thankful for the minister's wives as well. So the responsibility is about as much hers as it will be his. So keep them both in your prayer. And if you would you please stand, and we will go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Freddie, would you pray, please?
Father in heaven, we come humbly before you this evening, this special occasion. We thank you for this privilege that we have to come. And we pray, Father, your blessings on each portion of this service today. The ones that bring the message, the ones that give the charge, pray for Brother Stephen and his wife today. Bless them in their endeavors to carry the gospel wherever God calls them to carry. Thank you now for each one that's here today. Bless each one. Bless each church. Thank you for Christ that died for us. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. You can be seated, Teresa. Would you come to the piano, please? Everybody grab this little blue book, this little blue Heavenly Highway hymnal, and turn to page 141. Steve kept asking, well, what kind of song should I sing? What should we do? When should we do this? When should we do that? And I kept telling him this was his ordination. It was his option to choose what songs he wanted. And when he told me, the very first one, I thought, well, how appropriate that he picked this one out very first. Where He Leads Me, number 141. I did. The little Heavenly Highway Blue. My wife said to show y'all which book. Here it is. See, Brother David, I have the same problem here.
I will follow. I'll go with them.
number 78. It is truly an honor and a privilege to be able to turn the pulpit to one that I consider a dear friend, someone that I know that if I called and had a question to, if he did not know the answer, he would find out the answer. But more importantly, he is a man that has answered God's call. He is a man that is willing to fulfill the call that God has given him. And that is my prayer for everyone in this building today, is God, that you would answer the call that God has given you. But today, it is my honor and my privilege to turn the pulpit to Brother David Taylor. Brother David.
If you have the Bible, I'd like to invite you to turn to the book of 1 Timothy chapter 4. While you're turning there, let me say that I'm honored to be able to share this message this afternoon. I can somewhat relate with you, Brother Steve. I did not answer God's. God did. I don't know if God called me any sooner in life than He did, but I felt it when I was about 29 years of age, and. Wasn't what I wanted to do. In fact, I went into the ministry kicking and screaming, saying no. But it wasn't until I finally said yes that I found any of that peace that Sister just sang about. And so I understand what it's like to start maybe a little bit later in life than some do. And I don't think it really matters so much when you start, when God calls you, that you start. That's the important thing. Let me just say that this is an occasion that's not to be taken lightly. It is a calling that comes from God, and it is serious. I was taught through the Word and through example. This is not something to be considered lightly. And so I'm going to share some thoughts. After reading this chapter, it's only 16 verses. It's the Word of God, so it shouldn't bother us to read 16 verses. I want to share some thoughts with regard to ordination into the gospel ministry. We'll begin in verse number 1. 1 Timothy chapter 4. Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused if it is received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God in prayer. If you instruct the brethren in these things, you will be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished in the word of faith and of good doctrine, which you have carefully followed. But reject profane and old wives' fables. Exercise yourself toward godliness, for bodily exercise profits a little. But godliness is profitable for all things, having promise of the life that now is, that which is to come. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance. For to this end we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those who believe. These things command and teach. Let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, faith, impurity. Until I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by the prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the eldership. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident to all. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this you will save both yourselves and those who hear you. Father in heaven, we once again want to come before you and to ask your blessing on the reading of the scriptures. It's your word. Lord, may it speak to us today on this very special occasion. Bless now with the thoughts that you've laid upon my heart to share. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Every believer in Jesus Christ. Now, I say it that way because in our culture today, just to say every Christian doesn't cut it anymore.
No.
There are a lot of folk that call themselves Christian who are not.
Right.
Christian means Christ-like. So I prefer to use the phrase to every believer, every follower, everyone who will be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now, they will be Christian, but just to call yourself one is not necessarily make you a Christian. So to every believer, there is a divine expectation. I don't know about you, but when I was growing up, there were some things that my father expected from me. I know in our culture today that may not be quite the norm anymore, but in my home, where I grew up, there were some expectations. Mm-hmm. Dad expected you to get up, clean your room, make your bed. He expected you to go to school, pay attention. In fact, we were more concerned with the punishment we got at home than whatever we might get at school. That didn't scare us. What, go to the principal's office? That was nothing. Coming home facing Dad, oh, that's a whole other story. There were some expectations upon our life. I want to tell you something. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, there are some expectations God has for your life.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of those expectations is to be His witness. Just to let folk know about Jesus. To let them know that He went to the cross of Calvary, that He died there for our sins, that He was buried, that He rose from the dead, that He ascended to heaven, and He's coming back someday.
Yeah.
And He's going to judge every human being for their life and what they did with Him and His cross and His resurrection. There are no exceptions. No exceptions. Find me in the Bible, anywhere. Find me anywhere, and I'll take the statement back. But there are no exceptions to that. We're all to be His witnesses. Tell others about Him. However, there are times when God so chooses to call men to a special aspect of this witness. We call it the gospel ministry. God chooses men to a specialized place in His kingdom ministry. I recall reading my Bible, and there was a man named Moses, and God called his name out of the fiery bush that was burning. I can go all the way down through the scripture and come to the Apostle Paul. And he was there on the road to Damascus, and Christ called to him out of heaven, Paul, Paul, call his name. Call his name. And God chooses to do that. We call these fellows preachers. They call them preachers. Now, Paul writes here to Timothy. And later he'll write to Titus. He'll write two letters to Timothy. And he gives these young preachers some instructions relating to their call as ministers of the gospel. He talks to them about a number of things. Let me just identify a few of them. We don't have time to really get into them today, but I'll just hit them and kind of the highlights. First of all, he talks to them about their faithfulness to the calling. Faithfulness to the calling. Again, a term that we don't get to see thrown around and used and exercised a lot in our culture today. But being faithful to the calling, what you were called to do. He talks in these three books about some foundational truths. Here are some truths to build your life upon, to build your preaching ministry upon, to build the church upon. Foundational truths. He talks about false teachers. Be aware of them. They're out there. They're still out there. They were out there in Paul's day. They're still out there today. They sound good. They look good. And what they preach kind of is appealing. but it lacks the power or the truth of God's word. There are some false teachers. He talks to them about feeding the people of God. Feeding the people of God. I don't know where I would be for the last 45 years if my wife had not had the desire to want to fix breakfast or fix lunch or fix supper, fix a meal for me and when we had the kids at home, and she fed us. We were nourished. We were strengthened. We were able to continue to go about, do the things that we needed to do. And Paul talks to Titus and Timothy about feeding the people of God. He talks to them about fighting the good fight. Don't kid yourself. From the moment you get saved, your journey to heaven is not a walk in the park. And if you think it is, you're on the wrong walk.
Yeah.
Okay? The only park will be when you get to heaven in the garden. It's there. Now then it'll be a walk in the park. But till you get there, I believe Jesus called it a straight and narrow. That word narrow really means a difficult path. Difficult. So he talked to him about fighting the good fight. It's a fight. Battle the devil every day. Just because you answer the call to preach, don't kid yourself, Steve. You're going to battle him more than you ever have before.
Yeah.
He talks about the fruit of your labors. Sometimes it takes a few years. We just this morning about noon, little afternoon, some dear friends from Arizona, my second pastor at Tucson, they come to visit for a couple of days. And we sat around a couple evenings at our house and just visited and reminisced and talked about some things. Their son and his wife were with them and visiting with us. And I sat there and I listened to Mike. And I watched as a teenager in the church, and I'll be honest, like a lot of the kids that I, a lot of adults, I, you know, as I pastored, I'm thinking to myself, is he ever going to get it? Is he ever going to get it? And sitting there and listening to him talk, it really blessed my heart, because I don't know how much of it he got, but he got some of it. He got some of it. I think enough of it anyway. And I thought about that. That's kind of a fruit of my labor.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just kind of refreshing for me. It felt good. It kind of encouraged me a little bit to know that I accomplished a little something. A little something. There will be fruit. You may have to take a step back and look at it a little bit differently, but don't get lost in it. He talks to them about finishing the course. Finishing the course. And might I add, it's just not finishing it. I believe it's finishing well.
Yeah.
Finishing well.
Yeah.
Seen a lot of fellas run races. Now, running a race was not my thing. Okay, it wasn't my thing in school. Track was not my thing. I wasn't built for it. I've seen a lot of guys run races. And I've seen a lot of guys finish, but I saw them basically quit before they got to the finish line.
Mm-hmm.
They were just going through the motions when they got to the finish. And then I've seen some guys, and they ran through the finish line.
Yeah,
not just finishing the race, finishing it well. Well, with all that in mind, let me share with you, ask you two questions. The two questions deal with the gospel ministry. The first question is simply this: why do we preach? I think it's an important question. Why does God call a man, and why do we preach? The second question is simply this: if a man is going to preach, what do we preach? What do we preach? Well, let's look at the first question for just a minute. And Paul gives us a lot of things, not only in this chapter, but in other places that I'll refer to as well. We preach the gospel because we have a deep sense of a divine calling upon our life. So much so that we're going to do it when we otherwise would never think of doing it. I told you a little bit earlier, I didn't want to preach. I don't know about the other fellows here today, but I'm here to tell you, that was never on my radar. Never. I grew up in church. First, I was born on a Sunday. Following Sunday, I was in a Free Will Baptist church. Not a nursery, not a children's church. We didn't have those stuffs in those days. Some of you remember that. We just had church. And I've been in it all my life. And I never dreamed of being a preacher. Never. Didn't. I went against it. Somebody's got to do it. Brother Fred, it wasn't for me. I want to be a baseball player. Oh, yeah. I love baseball. In fact, sadly, my Giants lost today, but that's another story. I could see Willie Mays retiring, and I could take his place in center field. That's what I wanted to do. Yeah, right. Not even close. But that's what I wanted to do. That was my dream. I really did. I don't want to preach. But there came a time when God began to move in my life, in my heart, and I had a deep sense that this is what God wanted me to do. And I tried to talk him out of it. Wait a minute, Lord. You know good and well I don't have the personality. I don't have the oratory skills. You've already figured that out. I don't have the ability to do this. I was basically a pretty shy guy. I would get up with a group, but I didn't want the spotlight that sometimes goes with standing in this pulpit. But God says, I want you to preach. See, there was a deep calling. No matter what else I do in life, I have to preach. The divine calling is not an option. I'll do it for a little while. If it didn't work out, I'll go do something else. It's not an option. When God calls a man to preach, he has to preach. Mm-hmm. That's all there is to it. Sure. It's inescapable. You can deny it. You can run from it. You can hide from it. But I'm here to tell you, it is inescapable. You cannot get out of it. God calls you. You got to do it. It's irreversible. It's a life calling. It's a life calling. Paul was a tent maker by trade. Nothing wrong with that. He was a tent maker by trade. But he was a preacher by calling. Mm-hmm. Peter was a fisherman by trade. Nothing wrong with that. But he was a preacher by calling. Matthew was a tax collector by trade. A businessman. But he was a preacher by calling. I want you to know, the reason that we preach is because we have a deep, abiding sense that God has called us to this. My mother didn't call me the pastor. I promise you she didn't. She was horribly upset when I decided to take up my family and move to take my first pastorate because I went from California to Oklahoma. And that just, I took her two grandkids, her two oldest grandkids, and she was not happy. It took a number of years for her to get over it. I'm not sure I'm in the will still. My mother did not want me to preach. Now, she went against it, don't misunderstand me. If I could have stayed right at home, close around the place, she didn't care about me, it was the grandkids. Let's face it, all right? Let's be honest about it. My mother didn't call me to preach. My dad didn't call me to preach. In fact, he told me when I announced my call to preach, he said, son, you have made the biggest mistake of your life. Now, after I preached, I'd gone to my first pastor, and he came to visit. And after the first time he heard me preach after I was in the pastorate, he said to me, son, I think you're right where you need to be. Right where you need to be. But my dad didn't call me to preach. I preach. Every preacher ought to be preaching because he has a divine call upon his life. If you got that divine call, then what do you preach? What do you preach? There's a lot of guys out there preaching all kinds of things. Paul talks about the things that we ought to preach in this passage. I believe what we ought to preach, Paul talked about it and told the church, recorded by Luke in Acts chapter 20, I think verse 27, we ought to declare the whole counsel of God. Yeah. Now, I'll just be honest with you, I have a pet peeve. Okay? It drives me up a wall for preachers to get on their soapbox and that's all they ever preach. You know what I'm talking about. They get on their one little pet subject, and it doesn't matter where they start in the Bible, they end up on that one little pet subject, they get on it, and they nail it, and they nail it, and nail it. And that just drives me up the wall. I believe we ought to preach the whole counsel of God. There's good stuff in this book.
Yes.
Genesis to Revelation, chapter 1 to the last one, chapter 22. There's a lot of good stuff in there. Why stick with one chapter all your life? One verse, one thought, one topic, one theme. No, no, no. We ought to preach the whole counsel of God. Not the stuff we like to hear. Sometimes we've got to preach the stuff we don't want to preach.
Yeah.
They don't want to hear.
Yeah.
I can tell you right now, there's a lot of sermons I preached my congregation did not like it. But I didn't pick it. I really didn't. A lot of times I would preach through a book. That's the neat thing about preaching through a book, Steve. You start, say, you pick the book of, say, 1 Timothy, you start chapter 1, verse 1, and you just kind of go down through and preach, you know, through the book. You get to deal with whatever the book talks about. Sometimes what it talks about steps on people's toes.
Yeah,
you start meddling, that's true. Yeah. But the Bible does that, not me. So I just preach what the book says, and I just go right on through. The whole counsel of God means, first of all, I think, and it's kind of simplistic, but let me share it this way. The whole counsel of God means to preach so that Christ is exalted in worship. I really hope today that you do not leave here thinking about me first. I really hope you don't leave here today, in a sense, thinking about Brother Steve first. I hope you leave here today thinking about Jesus Christ. Because
amen.
It's because of Him
amen.
That I'm here, Steve's here, and we're all here. Preaching ought to exalt Christ in worship.
Yeah.
Lifting Him up. How many times, though, have we seen it? Boy, preaching lifts up the preacher.
Yeah.
Exalt Christ. It ought to exalt Him because of who He is and what He's done. See, I'm not the Son of God. I'm not. Now, there are some fellas out there that kind of put themselves in that category, but I'm not. And I didn't go to the cross and die for you. I like you, but I don't like you that much. I didn't go to the cross. We ought to exalt Christ in our preaching, in our worship, because of who He is, the Son of God, because of what He did, the cross of Calvary. Preaching ought to exalt Him because He's worthy of our worship. Let's go over just a moment. Turn to Revelation. Turn to chapter 4. I want you to just catch a few verses here. And I'm not going to pick and choose. I'll read two or three at a time so we don't just, you know, lift them out of the context there. But I want you to know, there's the picture. It's heaven. It's the throne. It's God there and the 24 elders and all that sort of stuff. Let's forget about that. Let's just look at the worship aspect, okay? Look at the worship aspect of it. Notice what it said in verse 8. The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within, and they did not rest night or day. Now, I know there's no night there. That's not it was the picture of, it's just all the time. All the time. Here's what they were saying. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. That's why we worship. Look at verse number 11. He says, "You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by you all things exist and were created." Look over in chapter 5. Look at beginning in verse 8. Now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song. Stop saying. Everybody talks about when we get to heaven, when we sing an Amazing Grace. We're going to sing How Great Thou Art. We're going to sing all kinds of songs. We've been singing down here for years. I'm not so certain we will. They were singing a new song.
Yeah.
One I haven't sung yet. They're going to invite me in it. Kind of, you know, just giving maybe my idea. They're going to invite me into the choir. And they're going to teach me a new song. And they sang it. And here's some of the words to it. Listen. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain. And you redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign. Look at verse 12. Saying with a loud voice again, here we hear this. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Listen, folk. When we worship, Steve, when we preach, The rest of my brothers who are here today, when we take the Word of God and open it and we declare the Word of God, we ought to exalt Christ in our worship. That's what our preaching ought to do. That's what we ought to preach.
Amen.
Secondly, our preaching ought to evangelize the lost. People are dying and they're going to hell at a rapid pace.
Yeah.
And their only hope is Jesus Christ. There are folks sitting in our churches who are lost and headed to hell. And their only hope is Jesus Christ. And we need to preach not only to exalt Christ in worship, but to evangelize the lost. It's real simple. The early church preached a very simple message. They preached Christ crucified, buried, and risen again. And wow, the church took off. People heard that message. They came to Christ. They came and they repented. They got saved. They were baptized. And the church exploded with growth. Maybe we need to just get back to preaching the simple message.
Amen. Yeah.
Christ crucified, buried, risen. We might throw in there a fourth one. He's coming again. So we need to be ready. You can go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 to 31. You can find all that in there. That's what Christ, what Paul talked about preaching. Finally, let me tell you, we need to also not only exalt Christ in worship, we need to evangelize the lost. But here's one I think that a lot of us, I'm talking about one of my own kind here, a lot of us preachers don't do as good a job as we ought to, is that we need to edify the believer. We need to edify the believer. I have seen far too many in my life folks come down and get saved, lead them to the Lord wherever it may be. They're in the church for a little while and then they're gone. They're off somewhere. You know why? Because they didn't mature. I mean, how many of you would bring a baby home from the hospital? How would you bring it home and you'd feed it for a couple of weeks, maybe a couple of months, change its diaper and all that sort of stuff, and then all of a sudden, you know what? Oh, I'm tired of this. I don't want to mess with it anymore. Just leave it to its own self. Well, you know what happened. Little child would die. What we do is we see folks get saved because they're grown-ups. We thought, you know what? Okay, you're a grown-up. You're not saved. All right, you just fend for yourself. Fellas, we need to edify the church. We need to build them up. See, there's more to good preaching than hellfire and brimstone.
Yeah.
All right? I'm not opposed to that. I mean, they need to hear that part. But there's more to good preaching than hellfire and brimstone. See, I believe building up the saints is every bit as important as evangelizing the lost. Newborn babes need to know who they are, what's taken place in their conversion. They need to begin to understand about justification. They need to understand about reconciliation. They need to understand about godliness. They need to understand about righteousness, about holy living. They understand that. And when they begin to understand that from God's perspective, what the Word has to say, they begin to grow and mature to the point where they can then lead someone else to Christ like they were led to Christ. Believers need to grow in their faith. They need a closer, a personal walk with Christ. They need to mature. See, preaching that edifies does several things. First of all, it teaches. It teaches people. They become familiar with the Word of God. Deb, my wife, Debbie, she got a message a couple of weeks ago from, well, he's now not a young man anymore. He's now in his, I guess he's probably in his, late 30s, Jimmy?
Late
40s. Late 40s, sorry, okay. The little one I thought it was. My first pastor, Jimmy Maxwell was his name. And, you know, like a lot, I can tell you about a previous young man, a teenager. He grew up there in the first pastor I had, and I wasn't too certain about whether he heard a thing I ever said. But he contacted her the other day. He said, you know, I remember when Brother David preached, and And he told us, and I don't remember exactly what it was now, but he said, I've remembered that. Could you tell me where that's at? Because I remember what he said. It's always stuck with me. When we preach to edify, it teaches, it trains, it tutors. But also to put us to the test. Now, these elements may not all be in every single sermon, but over the big picture, over a period of time, these elements ought to all be recognized in our preaching. Let me close by sharing this thought with you, Steve. There is no higher calling in life than to hear the voice of God call you, that still, small voice, and say, Steve, I want you to go and preach my message. There's no greater calling in life. I love being a grandfather. Preaching is a higher calling. Mm-hmm. I love it better than I love being a grandfather. Some of you might not understand that. But you guys that are preachers and your grandfathers, maybe you will. It's the highest calling in life. I wouldn't trade it to be president. I wouldn't trade it to be Bill Gates and have all his money. It's the highest calling a man could have. It's not one I chose. For some reason God did. I don't know if one you chose. Probably not. But God called you. And as you affirmatively answer that call, and keep in mind that preaching demands three things from you. First of all, prayer. You'll need to saturate everything you do in prayer. Pray over this book so you can understand it. Pray over the message you're going to preach so it will impact people's lives. Just saturate everything in prayer. But also there's a thing called preparation. I'm absolutely convinced that God is not going to bring anything to my mind that I haven't studied in this book. There's no record in here that he does that sort of thing. I had somebody one time say, well, what about Moses? Yeah, well, Moses lived with his mom and daddy until he was probably about 5 years old. And they taught and trained him. And when it came time, he remembered it. It had an impact on his life. The apostles, when that whole issue over helping out the widows in the church, you know what they said? We need to spend our time in study and prayer. You need to get these seven men over here to take care of that. You need to prepare. Thirdly, you need the power of God. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. He said, it's the power of God for salvation. If the power of God is not in your preaching, if you haven't prayed, it won't be there. If you haven't prepared, it won't be there. But if you've done those two things, and you put your trust in Him, He'll put His power in you and through you. He'll work, and He'll touch people's lives. Father in heaven, thank you for the day. Thank you for the opportunity to share some thoughts. I pray that, if nothing else, what we read from the Apostle Paul, Lord, it's touched our hearts today, reminded us of our responsibility and our calling in our life, and the task that is great, too great for us alone, but through you, nothing is impossible. Bless today in Jesus' name.
This time we will ask Brother David Downham to come forward and give the charge.
It's an honor to listen to good preaching to be a part of this service. Brother Steve is my biological brother, I guess most of you know. And I thought it might be important to dispel any rumors that might be that Brother Steve and I are not identical. He's been an awful good brother to me in life, and I've helped in an ordination service or observing ordination services through the years. I never thought it was appropriate for the preacher to just reminisce, so I'll be brief on that part. But being a biological brother, I wanted to share. I remember he's quite a bit older than me, and so it was hard on me when I was little to see him get old enough to go off and work, and it was bothering me for him to not be home as much as he was. And I remember a particular job he was working required him to stay in a motel. And when he'd get a day off, he'd come home to visit us. And he'd always bring me a bumper sticker or poster or some kind of token. Just tickled me to death as a little child. But I think one of my favorites was when he'd steal the bar of soap from the motel room. Now, wasn't that touching? And to think, 40 years later, you'd be helping in his ordination. Brother Steve's also been a good brother in Christ as well. He's always been very supportive of my personal walk with Christ and very supportive of my ministry. In fact, the minister's manual, which I'll be delivering the charge tonight, was a gift from him after my ordination in 1995. And again, could reminisce a lot, much could be said, many memories could be shared, but I'll proceed with the charge. Brother Steve, I'll ask you to come right here, if you will, for the question. You are fully aware of the responsibilities that are about to be placed upon you by being ordained and set apart as an ambassador of Jesus Christ. Therefore, with this knowledge, are you ready and willing to assume the responsibility?
I am.
Do you accept the Bible as being the inspired and infallible Word of God?
I do.
Recognizing the sacred responsibility of your calling and being aware of your own human weakness, will you seek to be directed and empowered by the Holy Spirit in order that you may be a faithful minister of Him who has called? Some of our scripture may be repetitious with Brother David, and we didn't even discuss it because we figured that it might be. But somewhere in the Bible says for it to be repetitious, not grievous for us. It's good reminders for us. So to give the charge tonight, we follow after the example that is given to us as found in the Word of God, as spoken in the charge of the Apostle Paul to his son in the faith, Timothy. I charge thee, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead, at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy, the laying on of the hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue thou in these things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. Remembering that all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Now blessed be the word of the Lord. My brother, as a minister, you must never forget that you have been called of God to preach, that you are called to the highest and most noble calling in the world, and that you should approach it with such an holy awe as to do no violence to the sanctity of your profession. Remembering, realizing that the sermon preached by the life of the preacher carries a far more weight than that that is preached from the pulpit. Therefore, you are charged to let your life be an example, and as it is written in the book of Jude, to keep yourself in the love of God. Your calling is not revocable. It should never become regrettable. For the works and callings of God are without repentance.
That's right.
Yeah.
And no trials beset you. Press through them in godly wisdom and with great grace and faith, knowing that God errs not in his calling, and must surely have a far greater plan than what man is able to comprehend. Knowing that since you have pressed through those trials in faith, then it is your faith itself that will grow greater glory. Brother Steve, you are charged to be a preacher, called to be a preacher. Now you're hereby charged. There may be differing details of the duties that fall upon you. Man may try to distort the details and the definitions of who should be an evangelist, pastor, or other form of ministry, but you are charged to heed only to the voice of the one who called you. God is not the author of confusion. Just as he has called you, he will sweetly direct you furthermore in your secondary endeavors. May God forbid if any circumstance should force you to walk alone, then walk alone in your calling nonetheless. For he is a friend that sticketh closer
Amen.
Than a brother.
That's right. Amen.
That's right.
Blessings from he who called you will often be your reward and many times be the only pay you receive. But if not one more blessing should ever fall upon you, you may rest well in knowing that life eternal is promised to you and to the many souls. The last verse in Brother David's text was that it will save you and those that heed to it. Eternal life is promised to you and those that you may reach by your preaching of the gospel, and who place their faith in Jesus Christ as their Savior, and who pledge their fidelity to the one and only true and living God, beside whom there is none other. Your work will never be done, and it may grow very tired. While tiring it might be, weeping will only do it for a night, but joy will come in the morning.
Amen.
Right?
Right. Amen.
And then at the close of life's final day, you will hear the words, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Now you can rest."
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Enter into the everlasting joys. Everlasting. Don't you love that word?
Yeah.
Joys of which there shall be no end. My personal prayer is that you are blessed with a long, prosperous ministry. Many souls are granted unto you for your labor, and that long years after this night, after many ups and downs, after unforeseen discouragements might come your way, that an opportunity is afforded to you to reaffirm your faith, to revisit the solemn occasion, to refresh your noble duties that are now placed upon you, and that something might happen that would called you to pause, maybe even force you to reread those scriptures Brother David shared with us. To expound upon the charge and the callings, the duties. Or is your invitation unto me to take part in this service tonight has stirred my soul and rekindled my fire, caused me to ponder on the mysteries, blessings, and eternal reward of this noble calling after many years. I pray that you're likewise blessed. Brother Steve, I charge you in the sight of God, who guideth all things, and before Christ Jesus, who before Pontius Pilate witnesseth a good confession, that thou keep the commandment without spot, unrebukable, and for how long? Until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you.
At this time, I would ask Brother Steve and Sister Vicki, if they would, to come down to the front. And I would like to ask all the ordained to come forward as we lay on hands and pray over them for their ministry. So would all the ordained please come forward. Ministers, deacons. y'all would gather around as we lay hands upon them. Pray a prayer of blessing over them. Brother Kenneth, would you lead the prayer, please?
Heavenly Father,
we thank
God for coming today. Lord, we thank you for life. We thank you for the blessings of God. We thank you, Lord, for your knowledge. God, I pray, Lord, today that God will just touch Brother Stevens to speak tonight, God. Lord, as they go forth to spread your word, God, I pray, Lord, that you just touch them, Lord, with your love and with your mercy. Father, I pray, God, today that, Lord, you would just give them the strength and the courage, Heavenly Father. Lord, when things get tough, Lord, when they feel like just giving up, God, I pray, Lord, today, God, that you just touch them. God, I pray, Lord, that you just give me the words to say. God, when you stand in front of people, God, Lord, knowing that you will give him the words, Father, give him courage, Heavenly Father, to preach what you have called him to preach. God, I pray, Lord, that you just give him the strength. God, just help him in his walk with thee. And we'll praise you in the name of Jesus, we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
You guys can be seated except Stephen B. Now, we have laid hands upon them. We have prayed upon them. I would encourage you and I admonish you to be in prayer for them every day. They are stepping out on a path that few understand. The ministers that are here today understand the path that they're stepping on. But you must understand that they're going to need prayer. They're going to need the shoulders to lean on every now and then, Brother Freddie. So remember them. Lift them up when you pray. That God would go with them, and God would direct them, and God would guide them. And not only as a dear friend of Steve and Vicki, God brought us together, what, 10, 12 years ago? I had seen them around when they had the photography business doing different graduations and different things at different schools. I knew them when I seen them, and then when we was at Baker's Creek, they was looking for a church. And if you know Baker's Creek, you could set the whole building just about down inside this little room right here. And they came and they was with us, and we got to be good friends with them. They are someone that we think very much of. But it is an honor to have him not only as a brother in Christ, but as a brother in the ministry. And what God has in store for them, where God lead them, God only knows. But we trust and we pray that they will be willing to go. Brother David came from California. Smartest move he ever made was leaving California. See, God knows what he's doing. God knows what he's doing. Now, why he put him in Oklahoma, I don't know. But at least he got him out of there and got him in Arkansas. So, we're glad and we're thankful. And Brother Steve, it is my honor and my privilege to present to you with your certificate. Ordination, and that's a piece of paper that says that you're a minister. But God is the one, and has been mentioned, that called him and gave him the desire to choose this calling of work. Be in prayer for him. At this time, we're going to have the closing prayer, but we're going to do it a little bit different. We're going to leave them here. We're going to ask Jeffrey if he would to go to the piano. We're going to have a closing prayer, but then I want you to come through, shake their hands, hug their necks, cry a little bit if you want to, laugh with them if you want to, but promise them one thing, that you will encourage them and lift them up to God in prayer. And don't nobody leave. There is some finger foods in the back, so everyone stick around and partake of some of the finger foods that have been prepared. So at this time, if you would please stand. You want to say something?
I want to say something real quick.
Sit down.
No, it's going to be quick. I am so honored by you guys being here. You know, some of you have to be here because you're family. and I understand that. And when I look out here, these people that didn't have to be here today, that could have been home sitting under the air conditioner, could have been doing whatever, it is so touching to see who showed up. I got some good friends that are Masons. I got some good friends that I've known all my life. Matter of fact, he went with me when I proposed to Vicky, and I still talk to him. But I'm so honored by you guys being here, every one of you, and I want to thank you so much.
You done?
I'm done.
Okay. That's the shortest message you'll ever preach, I promise you. So if you would you please stand and let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you, God, for this time of gathering as different people from different backgrounds of life, Lord, and different walks of life, different churches, maybe even different denominations, can come together in a show of support for this, our brother, who has accepted the call that has been laid upon him. And God, now we ask that as we leave this place, Lord, that we would not leave you inside this building, but that you would be in our hearts and in our minds, and we would take you everywhere that we go. And God, we ask that you would be with Brother Steve and Sister Vicky as they endeavor to do and walk the walk that you have bestowed upon them. Through the good times, through the bad times, the easy times, the hard times. And Lord, may they know that they can call upon anyone in this room and ask for prayer, ask for help, and Lord, that we would be willing to give. But Lord, may they understand that ultimately they must call upon you. Guide and direct their path. Guide and direct their walk. Be with each and every one that is here today. Go with us, guide and direct, for we ask in thy name. And amen. If you would, just when Jeffrey starts playing, come through, shake their hand, and make your way back to the back, and we have some refreshments back there.